Hi dear students, today we will talk about muscles of lower limb. So these are the muscles that can be seen on the thigh region, anterior aspect of the thigh region. They are sartorius. Sartorius is the longest muscle of the body. It is a ribbon like muscle. Then there are a group of muscles. They are called quadriceps femoris. Quadriceps femoris contains vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, vastus intermedius. Vastus intermedius is between vastus medialis and vastus lateralis, and deep to rectus femoris. So rectus femoris is superficial. When you remove the rectus femoris, there is another muscle which is deep to it, that is vastus intermedius, that is between vastus medialis and vastus lateralis. So in this picture you cannot see the vastus intermedius, you can only see the rectus femoris. And these are the origins of these muscles: vastus lateralis origin, vastus medialis origin from the femur, vastus intermedius origin, sartorius origin from the hip bone. And all these muscles are, the quadriceps femoris muscles are inserted to the patella. Patella is a sesamoid bone. Sartorius, it is attached to the tibia, on the medial aspect of the tibia. This is sartorius muscle. Origin from the hip bone, insertion to the tibia. Action, abductor and lateral rotator of the thigh. So it causes abduction of the thigh and the lateral rotation. So thus leading to a position as that of a tailor. So this muscle is called tailor's muscle. Nerve supplies, femoral nerve. Femoral nerve is a nerve which is supplying the anterior aspect or the anterior compartment of the thigh. Quadriceps femoris muscles, they are a group of muscles as I mentioned before, consist of four parts, four muscles. Each muscle has different origin from the femur, but rectus femoris arises from hip bone. So the muscles are vastus medialis, vastus lateralis, rectus femoris, and deep to that vastus intermedius. Now when we see the muscles, all the muscles, they are originating from the femur excepting rectus femoris. Rectus femoris is originating from the hip bone. And forms a common tendon. All the muscles together form a common tendon distally, and they are inserted to the base of the patella. Again, nerve supply is femoral nerve. Action, extensor of the knee. So it can cause extension at the knee joint. So they are the extensor muscles, and we are seeing the extensor compartment of the thigh. Coming to femoral triangle is a small depression that can be seen on the anterior aspect of the thigh, which is represented here. The boundary is superiorly by inguinal ligament, laterally by sartorius, medially by adductor longus muscle. Rectus longus muscle is lying here in this area, and the floor is formed by iliopsoas muscle laterally, iliacus muscle and the psoas muscle together called iliopsoas muscle. Pectineus is another muscle, so this forms the floor. The contents are femoral nerve most laterally, then femoral artery, femoral vein. These structures are not represented here in this diagram, but they are the contents of femoral triangle from lateral to medial: femoral nerve, femoral artery and femoral vein. So femoral triangle has got an apex that is distally placed, and this is the base. Femoral sheath, so contents can be seen in the femoral triangle. So femoral nerve, femoral artery, femoral vein can be seen. The proximal part of the femoral artery and the vein, both of them are covered by a sheath, or it's a modification of deep fascia that is in that region, and that's called femoral sheath. There are three compartments for the femoral sheath. So again, a diagram where the femoral nerve, femoral artery and the femoral vein can be seen. And the structure which you can see here is the femoral sheath, which is covering the femoral vessels. The lateral compartment has got femoral artery and femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. Middle compartment consisting of the femoral vein. So femoral nerve is not inside the femoral sheath, it is outside, but the femoral artery, femoral vein, they are inside, forming the lateral aspect, the lateral compartment that has the artery, and the middle compartment which has got the femoral vein, and the last medial one that consists of femoral canal and contains lymph nodes of cloquet. There are a group of lymph nodes in this area where it forms the femoral canal also, and they have lymph nodes. So we'll have a lateral compartment, a intermediate compartment or the middle compartment, and the medial compartment is here. Again, the structures can be seen here: the femoral vein, artery and the femoral nerve. Adductor canal is a continuation of the femoral canal, that's here. The femoral canal base and the apex of the femoral canal continues as the adductor canal. So this part continues as the adductor canal. Adductor canal leads to an opening, and that is adductor hiatus. So it is located in the middle third of medial side of front of thigh. So it is almost in the middle third of the thigh. From the apex to femoral triangle to the opening in adductor magnus. So it is starting from the apex of femoral triangle and it leads to the adductor hiatus. Adductor hiatus is the opening in the adductor magnus muscle. Adductor magnus muscle is a muscle which is seen in the medial compartment of the thigh that has got an opening, and that is adductor hiatus. So adductor canal is leading from the apex of femoral triangle up to adductor hiatus. Boundaries are anteromedially vastus medialis, anterolaterally sartorius. Sartorius is seen anterolaterally. Posterior wall, adductor longus above and adductor magnus below. Contents are saphenous nerve. Saphenous nerve is a branch of femoral nerve. Nerve to vastus medialis. Nerve to vastus medialis is again a branch of femoral nerve. Femoral vessels are the femoral artery and the femoral vein. Subsartorial plexus of nerves lie between the sartorius and the muscles forming the boundaries of the adductor canal. So the roof, there is a roof, that roof is mainly formed by sartorius. So between the sartorius and the structures which are forming the roof, which is the deep fascia, we can see subsartorial plexus of nerves. These nerves are seen below the sartorius muscle, so it's called subsartorial plexus of nerves. It is not root, this roof, spelling mistake. Now let's see the muscles in the posterior compartment, and the muscles of the posterior compartment of the thigh are called hamstring muscles. And they are biceps femoris, semitendinosus muscle, semimembranosus muscle, semimembranosus lying deep to semitendinosus on the medial aspect. Biceps is seen on the lateral aspect. Adductor magnus. Adductor magnus is a muscle which is seen in the adductor compartment and also posterior compartment. Adductor compartment is the medial compartment. Okay. Now it has got two parts, adductor part and ischial part. Adductor part belongs to medial compartment, ischial part belongs to posterior compartment. So adductor magnus, the ischial part of the adductor magnus. Or you can say the muscle, the part of the adductor magnus arising from the ischial tuberosity. Ischial tuberosity, you can see the ischial tuberosity here, and that belongs to the hamstring muscles or hamstring group of muscle. Let's see the biceps femoris. Can be seen here as a long head and a short head. Origin from long head is originating from the ischial tuberosity. Ischial tuberosity. Long head. Short head is arising from the femur. And both of them unite and they are inserted to the fibula. Fibula is the lateral bone of leg. Nerve supply is sciatic nerve. Sciatic nerve is the nerve that can be seen on the posterior compartment. We have seen the femoral nerve. Femoral nerve is seen on the anterior aspect of the thigh or anterior compartment of the thigh. Similarly, sciatic nerve is the nerve which is going to supply the posterior compartment of the thigh. Next muscle, that is semitendinosus. So remember here one thing, biceps femoris is seen on the lateral aspect. Semitendinosus is seen on the medial aspect. And it is originating from the ischial tuberosity. And it is inserted to the tibia. Nerve supplies tibial part of sciatic nerve. So the sciatic nerve supplies the muscle here. Origin from ischial tuberosity, as we described before, insertion to the tibia. The next muscle, that is semimembranosus. So again, semimembranosus is a muscle which is seen on the medial aspect, deep to semitendinosus. Semitendinosus is resting on semimembranosus. In fact, can be seen here, semimembranosus. Origin from ischial tuberosity, insertion to the tibia, and nerve supply is tibial part of sciatic nerve. So sciatic nerve has got two parts, peroneal part and tibial part. Okay, tibial part is supplying semimembranosus. Action of this muscles, biceps femoris, semitendinosus, semimembranosus are chief flexors of the knee. So they are seen on the posterior compartment, and the posterior compartment muscles of the thigh are called the flexor compartment because it causes flexion of the leg or the knee. Now let me tell you one thing here. So we have hamstring muscles here. I'm just revising it once again. Biceps femoris, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, adductor, magnus. So here biceps femoris has got two heads, long head and short head. So you can include here only the long head. Long head is a part of hamstring group of muscles, whereas short head is not a part of hamstring muscle. Semitendinosus, yes, hamstring. Semimembranosus is a hamstring. Adductor magnus, only the ischial part. The ischial part is coming under hamstring muscle. Adductor part is not coming in hamstring group. That you should be careful. Okay. Now let's see the muscles in the medial compartment. Medial compartment muscles are pectineus, adductor longus, adductor brevis. Adductor brevis, adductor magnus. Adductor magnus is a big muscle. Gracilis. So pectineus, adductor longus can be seen, then adductor brevis, adductor magnus. So pectineus here, adductor longus, they are in the same layer, just deep to that adductor brevis, then you have adductor magnus in the deep layer. Now all the muscles of this region causes adduction at hip joint. And these are supplied by obturator nerve. So obturator nerve supplying all the adductor muscles. Obturator nerve is coming from lumbar plexus. Adductor magnus. Adductor magnus is a large muscle that can be seen on the medial compartment, originating from inferior ramus of the pubis, ramus of the ischium, and the ischial tuberosity. So the part of the adductor magnus arising from the ischial tuberosity is the hamstring part. The remaining part belongs to the adductor part of adductor magnus. So insertion, the pubic part that is inserted to the posterior surface of the shaft of femur, whereas the ischial part that is attached to the adductor tubercle of the femur. So there is a gap between the insertion point of the adductor part and the ischial part, and this gap is adductor hiatus. Nerve supply of pubic part is obturator nerve, whereas the ischial part is by sciatic nerve. Specifically speaking, the tibial part of sciatic nerve that supplies the ischial part of adductor magnus. Now action, the pubic part causes adduction and lateral rotation of the thigh region or the thigh. Ischial part is causing extension of the hip and flexion of knee. So ischial part belongs to the hamstring group of muscles, or the muscles which are seen on the posterior compartment of the thigh. So they are flexor compartment or the hamstring compartment, whereas the pubic part belongs to the adductor compartment. So adductor magnus is such a muscle which is present in the medial compartment and also the posterior compartment of the thigh. So medial compartment is the pubic part, and the posterior compartment or the flexor compartment, that is the ischial part. So we have seen that the ischial part is attached to the adductor tubercle, but the insertion point of this adductor part also extends from the femur to the tibia.
and that extension is called the tibial collateral ligament. Tibial collateral ligament. So in fact, the ischial part of adductor magnus is even attached to the tibia through the tibial collateral ligament. Now gluteal region. So this is a gluteal region or the buttocks region. Muscles of gluteal region, they are gluteus maximus, big muscle. Deep to that, gluteus medius can be seen, gluteus medius in this area, deep and anterior to gluteus maximus. Gluteus minimus again anteriorly and bit deep, gluteus minimus. Piriformis, piriformis is a muscle which is seen at the same level of gluteus minimus, the same plane of gluteus minimus, piriformis. Gamellus superior, gamellus superior, this is gamellus superior. So again, this is piriformis, gamellus superior, gamellus inferior, gamellus inferior is here. Obturator internus is here. So between gamellus superior, gamellus inferior, there is obturator internus. So gamellus superior, gamellus inferior, obturator internus can be seen. Quadratus femoris is a muscle that is lying below inferior gamellus. So below inferior gamellus, quadratus femoris also can be seen. Obturator externus cannot be seen in this, but it is present on the opposite side, anterior side. That is, if you remove the obturator internus, then you can see obturator externus anteriorly. Tensor fasciae lata is a muscle that again can be seen anterior to the gluteus minimus in the same plane. So we have seen that muscles gluteus maximus, medius minimus, and we have seen piriformis, gamellus superior, obturator internus, gamellus inferior, quadratus femoris. These muscles can be called as the short lateral rotators of the thigh because it causes rotation of the thigh. Gluteus maximus can be seen in this diagram, a big muscle originating from the iliac crust. Iliac crust is here, this is iliac crust. Posterior gluteal line, posterior gluteal line, posterior part of gluteal surface of ilium behind the posterior gluteal line, this area. Sacrum, sacrum is this one, sacrum. Coccyx is below the sacrum. Sacrotuberous ligament is a ligament that is connecting sacrum to the ischial tuberosity, sacrotuberous ligament. So from this area, gluteus maximus originate, insertion to the femur, bone, and iliotibial tract. So insertion is to the femur and also to the iliotibial tract. So insertion can be seen onto the femur, some part is attached to the iliotibial tract. Okay. Tensor fasciae lata also can be seen, that is attached to iliotibial tract. It's a modification of defascia, iliotibial tract here. Can be seen here, iliotibial tract, this area, this is iliotibial tract. Modification of the fascia on the lateral side of the thigh is iliotibial tract. Two muscles are inserted to it, tensor fasciae lata and the gluteus maximus. Tensor fasciae lata and the gluteus maximus. Some part of gluteus maximus, some part is attached to the femur. Nerve supply is inferior gluteal nerve. Gluteus maximus is the chief extensor of the thigh and the hip joint. So the gluteus maximus causes extension of the hip. This action is important in rising from sitting position. So we can say that it is a powerful extensor of the thigh at the hip joint. There are other muscles which causes extension of the thigh at the hip joint. They are the hamstring group of muscles. But the extension that is caused by gluteus maximus is more powerful, like rising from a sitting position. That in that time there is an extension of the hip that occurs. That is because that is done by gluteus maximus. Other actions are lateral rotation of the thigh, abduction of thigh. So upper fibers of gluteus maximus are doing this function, abduction of thigh. And along with tensor fasciae latae, it stabilizes the knee joint. Because tensor fasciae latae and the gluteus maximus, we have seen it, it is inserted to the iliotibial tract. So iliotibial tract is a deep modification of deep fascia here, and that is attached to the tibia inferiorly, so it can stabilize the thigh or the knee. Gluteus medius is the next muscle, can be seen here. Origin from the ilium, insertion to the femur, insertion point is cut here. Nerve supply is superior gluteal nerve. Gluteus medius also can be seen in this area, and this is the insertion point of gluteus medius on the femur. Gluteus minimus is the next muscle, which is deep to gluteus medius. Origin from the ilium, insertion to the femur, nerve supply is superior gluteal nerve. So gluteus medius and minimus are supplied by superior gluteal nerve, whereas gluteus maximus is supplied by inferior gluteal nerve. Piriformis is known as the key muscle of gluteal region. There are some structures which passes above the piriformis, and there are some structures which are passing below the piriformis. The structures passing above the piriformis are called superior, for example superior gluteal nerve. Similarly, the structures passing inferior to the piriformis are called inferior, for example inferior gluteal nerve and vessels. So that is why it's called the key muscle of this region. Origin from the sacrum, anterior aspect of the sacrum and the hip bone. Insertion to the femur, disinserted to the femur. Piriformis originating from the sacrum. Nerve supply is ventral rami of the spinal nerve S1, S2. Muscles of anterior compartment of the leg. The leg has got three compartments: anterior compartment, lateral compartment, and the posterior compartment. Let's see first the anterior compartment of the leg. The muscles are tibialis anterior, extensor hallucis longus, extensor digitorum longus, peroneus tertius. Peroneus tertius is a very small muscle, which is a part of extensor digitorum longus. This is peroneus tertius. All the muscles of anterior compartment are dorsiflexors of the foot, so it causes dorsiflexion or extension of the foot at the ankle joint, supplied by deep peroneal nerve. And all these muscles are supplied by deep peroneal nerve. Deep peroneal nerve is a branch of common peroneal nerve. The muscles are tibialis anterior, originating from the tibia. Interosseous membrane is a membrane that is connecting tibia and the fibula. Insertion point is towards the base of first metatarsal bone. And the nerve supply is deep peroneal nerve. So tibialis anterior. Extensor hallucis longus. Extensor hallucis longus going to the big toe. Origin from the fibula. From the fibula, extensor hallucis longus. Interosseous membrane, insertion to the big toe. Nerve supply is deep peroneal nerve. The insertion point of extensor hallucis longus can be seen. Next muscle in the anterior compartment is extensor digitorum longus. Extensor digitorum longus. extensor digitorum longus is similar to the extensor digitorum of the upper limb, originating from tibia. So originating from the tibia, okay, this is the origin of extensor digitorum. It extends up to the tibia, fibula and the interosseous membrane also. Insertion, it split into four tendons for the medial four toes, and it is inserted to the it is splitting for lateral four toes, and it is inserted to the lateral four toes, supplied by deep peroneal nerve. So the extensor digitorum longus can be seen as dividing into four tendons and inserted to the lateral four toes. There is a small muscle that can be seen here, that is extensor digitorum brevis, which is also related to extensor digitorum longus, but both are separate muscles. Peroneus tertius is a small muscle, or fibularis tertius, which is a part of extensor digitorum longus, can be seen here. So peroneus tertius origin, fibularis tertius origin can be seen from the fibula and the interosseous membrane. Insertion to the fifth metatarsal insertion point. Now let's see the muscles of lateral compartment. Lateral compartment muscles are fibularis longus and fibularis brevis. Fibularis longus is superficial. When you cut fibularis longus, the deep muscle that can be seen is fibularis brevis. Fibularis brevis is short while comparing to the fibularis longus. And the nerve supply here is superficial peroneal nerve, which is again a branch of common peroneal nerve. Actions are plantar flexion and eversion. So this is the two actions of the muscles on the lateral compartment: plantar flexion and eversion. Let's see the origin insertion. Peroneus longus, it is originating from the fibula. Insertion to the first metatarsal and medial cuneiform bone. So this muscle that goes downwards and passes onto the sole from the lateral aspect, then it passes through the sole and it is inserted to the medial bones, like the base of the first metatarsal and also medial cuneiform. So it moves from lateral to medial in the sole. Peroneus brevis is a muscle which is deep to peroneus longus, as already explained, originating from the fibula, peroneus brevis, and insertion to the base of fifth metatarsal. So this muscle is inserted to the lateral side, whereas peroneus longus is inserted to the medial side, passing through the sole. Muscles of posterior compartment of leg. Here these muscles are arranged in different layers: superficial layer, which includes gastrocnemius muscle. So gastrocnemius is a bulky muscle. Plantaris muscle, soleus muscle. Intermediate layer are flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus, and the deep layer are tibialis posterior popliteus muscles. So let's see the compartments here. This is the tibia and fibula, a cross section, and the interosseous membrane that can be seen in this area, and different layers can be seen in this posterior compartment. This is the posterior compartment. So the superficial layer is this region, and the intermediate layer can be seen here, and the deep layer can be seen in this area. So superficial, intermediate layer, and the deep layer can be seen. Deep layer is very close to the interosseous membrane. Now let's see the muscles here. Gastrocnemius is superficial muscle, gastrocnemius. Plantaris is another muscle which is deep to gastrocnemius. Soleus is again deep to the gastrocnemius and the soleus. So plantaris lies between gastrocnemius and the soleus. Plantaris is a small muscle. Intermediate layer, when we cut the soleus, we can see the intermediate layer. They are the flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus. Two muscles can be seen. And the deep layer, that is tibialis posterior, in between these two muscles, but it is deeper level, and popliteus is seen in the upper aspect of the leg. Let's see some muscles here. Gastrocnemius can be seen. Origin from femur. It has got two origins. It has got medial head and the lateral head. That's why I said two origin. Medial and lateral head of origin. And these villi's, they unite here and forms a tendon in the lower aspect, and that is inserted to the calcaneum. Calcaneus. Nerve supply is tibial nerve. Tibial nerve is a branch of sciatic nerve. The next muscle here is soleus muscle. The origin of the soleus can be seen. The soleus is here. After removing the gastrocnemius, soleus can be seen. Soleus muscle looks like salt fish, that is why the name is given. Above the soleus, plantaris muscle also can be seen. So originating from the fibula and the tibia, fibula and the tibia, both the bones, insertion to the calcaneum. So again, the soleus forms a flat tendon that is inserted to the calcaneum. Nerve supplies tibial nerve. So tibial nerve is a nerve which is supplying the posterior compartment of the leg. Plantaris is another muscle which is again in the superficial compartment of the leg, the posterior compartment. Plantaris muscle originating from the femur. So from the femur originating and inserted to the calcaneum. So this muscle is also inserted to the calcaneum. Nerve supply is tibial nerve. So here the plantaris muscle, sometimes it can be absent. The gastrocnemius and the soleus are strong plantar flexors of the foot and the ankle joint. So gastrocnemius and the soleus, they are plantar flexors. So you can see the plantar flexion here, which is done by the posterior group of muscles. Soleus is more powerful than the gastrocnemius, but latter is faster acting. So there are two muscles, soleus and gastrocnemius. The soleus is more powerful and it can act for a long time, whereas gastrocnemius is not so powerful, but it is very quick in action and it gets tired very fast, gastrocnemius. Because gastrocnemius is a white muscle and soleus is a red muscle. Soleus and gastrocnemius together form a tendon called tendocalcaneus, which is attached to calcaneus. So the both muscles, gastrocnemius and the soleus, they form a common tendon that is inserted to the calcaneus. That's called tendon of Achilles. So it can be very important, and tendon of Achilles can be asked in exams. And it's also called tendocalcaneus. Here you can see that the anterior compartment muscles causes dorsiflexion of the foot, whereas posterior compartment causes plantar flexion of the foot. So that's the difference. Another muscle, popliteus, So popliteus muscle is a muscle that action is causes unlocking the knee. It's popliteus muscle and unlocks. That means it is rotating the femur laterally during initial stage of flexion of the knee. While your knee is extended, it is locked position, completely extended. That is called the locked position. But when you flex the knee, initially there is requirement of unlocking of the femur, and that is done by the popliteus muscle. So you can say unlocking is the first stage of flexion of knee. So flexor digitorum longus. So it causes flexion of lateral four toes. So flexor digitorum longus can be seen inserted to the lateral four toes, dividing into four tendons. So it looks like flexor digitorum superficialis or flexor digitorum profundus of the hand. Now these are the different layers of the sole. The muscles of the sole are conveniently described in four layers, from inferior layer to superior layer. So superficial to deep, these are four layers. There are four layers. So I'll just name the layers. The first layer is abductor hallucis, flexor digitorum brevis, abductor digiti minimi. Second layer, quadratus plantae, lumbricals, flexor digitorum longus tendon, flexor hallucis longus tendon. Third layer, flexor hallucis brevis, adductor hallucis, flexor digiti minimi brevis. Fourth layer consists of interossei, peroneus longus tendon, tibialis posterior tendon. So unlike the small muscles of the hand, the sole muscles have a few delicate functions and are chiefly concerned with supporting the arches of foot. So we have seen the intrinsic muscles of the hand, they have a particular function, but here the muscles in the sole are not having intricate function, but they do support the arches of the foot. Arches of the foot can be seen in the foot. There are two arches, a longitudinal arch and a transverse arch. Longitudinal arch can be lateral longitudinal arch and medial. So let's see these arches. So this is the arch that we can see, medial longitudinal arch, represented by A to C. And the other side, B to C, is the lateral longitudinal arch, and the transverse arch is from A to B is a transverse arch. And this transverse arch and the longitudinal arches are required for us to walk on uneven surfaces. There's a small depression in the back of the knee, and that's called popliteal fossa. So it's a diamond shaped space, a depression seen behind the knee. The boundaries are above, laterally by tendon of biceps is laterally seen, medially semi membranosus and semi tendinosus can be seen medially. Below are laterally, it is plantaris and lateral head of gastrocnemius, whereas medially, medial head of gastrocnemius. Contents are tibial nerve, common peroneal nerve. So tibial nerve and common peroneal nerve are divisions of sciatic nerve. Popliteal artery is a continuation of femoral artery. Popliteal vein continues as femoral vein. Popliteal lymph nodes are some of the lymph nodes can be seen here. Popliteal femoral cutaneous nerve, which is a cutaneous nerve. Lot of fat in this area. Short saphenous nerve. Short saphenous nerve also can be seen. Smaller geniculate branches of posterior division of obturator nerve. Some branches of obturator nerve also can be seen in this. Obturator nerve is seen in the medial compartment, and that reaches up to here. There are retinaculum of leg. We have seen the extensor retinaculum and the flexor retinaculum of the wrist region. Similarly, there are retinaculum can be seen near the ankle. In the anterior compartment, there is superior extensor retinaculum, which is extending between anterior border of the fibula to the anterior border of tibia. That is extensor retinaculum, superior extensor retinaculum. Superior extensor retinaculum. Inferior extensor retinaculum can be seen below, which is Y-shaped structure. Y-shaped structure. Stem is attached to the lower surface of the calcaneum. Stem is attached to the calcaneum. Calcaneum. Upper limb is attached to the medial malleolus. Medial malleolus is a elevation that can be seen on the medial aspect, which is because of the tibia. Lower limb is attached to the plantar aponeurosis. Plantar aponeurosis is a modification of deep fascia in the sole, so it goes up to the sole. Whereas the lateral compartment has got retinaculum. Again, there are two retinaculum, superior peroneal retinaculum and inferior peroneal retinaculum. So superior and inferior peroneal retinaculum can be seen. Superior one extending between lateral malleolus. Lateral malleolus is the projection here on the lateral aspect of the angle to the lateral surface of the calcaneum. Whereas inferior peroneal retinaculum, that is extending from the calcaneum up to the stem of the extensor retinaculum, this small part. And the posterior compartment, you can see the flexor retinaculum, which is connecting medial malleolus and the calcaneum. Thank you.